on general governmental operations, cultural affairs, appropriations, public debt, legal affairs, retirement, public parks, recreation, historic preservation of land will not come to order. We have four bills on the agenda today. The first bill was introduced by Senator Tina Winnie Barnes. And Bill 428, an act to add subsection F to section 8121 of Article 1, Chapter 8, Title 4 of the Guam Code annotated relative to establishing parity in the retirement annuity for the government of Guam. I want to thank my colleagues for joining me, Senator Addit and Senator Uggan and Senator Snicklis. On the first bill, I have two people that have signed up. We have the public auditor, Ms. Brooks, and Joe T. Snagstein from the board. All right, why don't you come? I'll note for the record that this morning the office received a letter in support of this legislation from the Attorney General elect.
Good afternoon, Senators. My testimony, my written testimony before you is very brief, but I'll just read it into the record. Okay, this is on Bill 428. We at OPA are in support of Bill 428, which would allow a Guam retiree to continue receiving his or her annuity when elected as Attorney General or Public Auditor. This benefit is already made available to retirees serving in the legislature, as well as numerous other positions in health, education, and public safety. We thank and acknowledge the main sponsor of Bill 428, Senator Tina Munya Barnes, for bringing parity to these two elected offices. We also pray that other disparate issues, such as OPA compensation staff, will also be addressed. We urge the committee's full support of this measure. Thank you and Merry Christmas.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. The board testimony, I'm representing the board here this afternoon, and our testimony is actually based on one is to hoping that we touch some kind of a semblance of order in what we have done over the years in suspending annuity payment or get them on, you know, various people. Over the years, the legislature have made some, a lot of concessions for a lot of people that can continue to receive their annuity payment, and as such, we have a long list of it already now. And actually, Mr. Speaker, we have never envisioned that a lot of our elected officials would end up being elected. We never thought of the AG or the auditor or, for that matter, and a lot of positions that would have been have a suspended annuity. And so over the years, you know, a listing of position, even bus drivers now, and school teachers. Actually started over mainly school teachers. Then from, you know, a social worker, and then next you know, a different kind of, and even public police officers now are involved. Bus drivers, the latest one. And so now, but with respect to these two positions, that was the subject of this afternoon's testimony, we have the elected official. We, as I said, we got the AG, and hopefully one of these days we're going to have an incumbent in the OPA that happened to be retired. And what do you do? So to be consistent throughout the system that we have gone through, we have no problem of adding these two people in there, because after all, everybody else seems to be. Before you know it, we're going to end up with just a few people not have their retirement suspended. In fact, there might be some consideration later on, because there are people in the managers of, say, GPA, Waterworks, and things like that. Those people, or even the university president, those people, because they're appointed by the board, their retirement annuity has been suspended. Everybody else, if the governor appoints you, then you don't have to get, you get your annuity suspended. But even the governor's office to have anybody else, except these areas like GPA, Waterworks, University of Guam, things like that, and GCC. So that's going to be the last remnant, and that's something else that you may want to close that. Either you give it to them or you don't. One of these days, those people
will cross that bridge.
That's, I know, that's what I'm saying. That's what exactly
that's
what we're doing.
Bridge
we're crossing the bridge now for the AG and anticipating the. Maybe
no,
I don't,
no,
I'm not,
not anticipating anything. It's a very
right.
short.
Very short.
Bridge.
Exactly. So that's. So I'm just giving you my our testimony, just to give you a history of what we have gone through, where we are now.
That'll make for a wonderful committee report. So thank you very much. Do any of the senators have questions?
That's it.
No?
Thank you
very much, senators. The second bill on today's agenda is Bill 431. Introduced by Speaker Judy Wompat, an act to amend subsection A and D of Title 17 Guam Code annotated to amend subsection A of Section 5008.2 of Title 5 Guam Code annotated relative to procurement of solar energy for GDOE schools. We'll note for the record that there have already received testimony from the Superintendent of Education. And this afternoon, I have two people signed up. Jeff and Scott. I use first names so I don't mess up the last names. Please, Jeff, Scott.
Thank you very much, Vice Speaker Cruz and the committee members. Good afternoon. My name is Jeff Ficola. I'm the president of the Guam Renewable Energy Association, or GREA. I thank all of you for the opportunity to testify on this important piece of legislation this afternoon. GREA is made up of over 25 companies, and now we have over 300 members. These companies are experts in all forms of renewable energy, and our industry leaders on the island of Guam in respect to renewable energy or alternate sources of power production. Bill number 7432 was passed on November 15, 2013 and signed into Public Law 3295 by Governor Calvo on November 27, 2013. The law authorized GDOE to enter into one or more PPAs under third-party ownership for all of its facilities and aid in reducing its cost for power production. It has now been 377 days since this bill was signed into law, yet the General Services Agency has yet to release a multi-step bid as required by Public Law 3295, and GDOE is still paying at least 20% more for its power. It has cost the taxpayer of Guam millions of dollars thus far, and will end up costing taxpayers $7 million more by the time GDOE finds any relief from this legislation designed to save its money. On November 25th, 2014, Speaker Wompat introduced Bill 431, which moves the procurement of this power purchase agreement from GSA to GDOE. The Guam Renewable Energy Association fully supports the intent of this bill to place the procurement of these PPAs under the supervision of an agency that understands the technical specifications of power production and the correct manner in which to issue an RFP that is bankable or financeable for these projects, and who can move forward and get this procurement out so GODE can see some relief from the higher cost of power. As we're all aware here today, fossil fuels are very volatile, because of this commodity of fossil fuel, power rates fluctuate from year to year. This law will not only provide GDOE the ability to save millions of dollars on their energy costs, but will also allow GDOE to hedge their energy costs for at least the next 20 to 25 years, and allow them to reprogram funds meant for power to add additional security, purchase textbooks, or whatever leadership of GDOE deems most important with these monies. Members of our member companies now are offering PPAs here on the island of Guam, and we understand the technical and financial structure of these agreements. Our association is more than capable and open to help in any way possible to get this procurement underway. Time is against us now. We've lost one valuable year in the procurement of this monumental and history-making project. At the end of 2016, the investment tax credit, or ITC, will expire. This leaves only 24 months to bid out these PPAs, award the contracts, and construct 36 solar systems on these GDOE facilities. This is already a daunting task, but it will be impossible if we waste any more time on this procurement. This can be, and still can be, a milestone project of cooperation between GDOE, GPA, and the renewable energy industry here on Guam. GREA has always applauded the 32nd legislature for their support of renewable energy on the island of Guam. Not only is this industry growing, we are providing employment, training in this new and exciting industry. We also are taxpayers, engage in business-to-business commerce, and most importantly, we are helping to clean up this beautiful island of Guam that can be a showcase for other island nations to follow. In every community, state, and territory, we need the leadership and guidance of our elected leaders to place in effect the laws and policy to make the reduction of fossil fuel a reality. But we also need an RFP that is bankable and financeable to have these projects move forward so GDOE can seek the relief from this high power production. As we are all aware, fossil fuels are a volatile commodity. Because of this volatility, power rates fluctuate from year to year. And I apologize, I already read that. But I think the holy grail here is the importance to clean up this planet. We need this legislation to be written so these laws can be implemented quickly. If nothing is done by 2050, the Earth is expected a temperature rise of 2 degrees Celsius, which will not only be catastrophic, but also at the point of irreversible damage. We are the leaders and the overseers of this planet for all the future generations to come. Again, thank you. I cannot stress enough that time is of the essence, and we have 2 years left to get this project underway and these projects built. So thank you for allowing me to speak. Thank you for supporting Law 3295 and for supporting Bill 43132 to find a solution to move this procurement process forward. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Brocaldo. Mr. Hagen.
Great job, Jeff. Just the words out of my mouth, and I'm glad to know we're, I'm glad to see we're on the same page. Holiday Senators, and happy holidays. I'm Scott Hagen, co-owner of Pacific Solar and Photovoltaics, and also a member of GREA with Jeff here. I want to ask you, what is the cost of doing nothing? Every month that goes by, the schools don't have solar panels on their roofs. They're paying more for power than they should. I once heard, and I heard it again this afternoon here, $17 million. So the cost of doing nothing for the public schools is $17 million. In the private sector, there's a saying, just get it done. Unfortunately, with GSA in charge of procurement and bureaucracy and politics and whatever else comes into play, we can't simply just get it done when in fact it should be just that simple. I don't recommend that we go about doing it recklessly as we sometimes do in the private sector. Of course, we need consultants, checks and balances, and so forth. And as Senator Judy was quoted in her PDN article, she was suggesting GPA. I know the best consultants are sitting in this room right now, and I'm talking about the renewable energy experts. Although GPA is known to be Guam's leader in power generation, there are no way Guam's expert in renewable energy. We the renewable energy folks have installed about 200 systems throughout Guam to date. TBA has installed Chiru. We, the energy folks, renewable energy folks, have energized about 2 megawatts of renewable energy distributed throughout Guam. GBA, zero. And I repeat, your consultants can be found right here in this room and through the Guam Renewable Energy Association. By going forward with 431, you'll be supporting and allowing to grow an industry that since 2008 has become a multi-million dollar industry. These numbers can be backed up. And did you know that in the beginning of this year, 2014, there were only about 100 net energy metering customers or systems throughout this island, and by the end of this year, in just about 2 weeks, there'll be 200. That's double. By the end of 2015, that number will double. At the end of 2016, that number will double again. And that's not speculation, but it's an educated forecast based on the market trends that we're starting to see here on this island. What comes along with creating and allowing to flourish a multi-million dollar industry? I don't need to go down all the line items, GRT, and so on and so forth. You senators are awesomely smart, but if you want data, again, you can look to the Guam Renewable Energy Association, the experts. I can go on and on about my favorite topic, but in case something got lost in translation, I support 431.
Thank you very much, Mr. Hagen. Let me read into the record the short sponsor statement that was provided by the speaker. Public Law 32-095 was enacted over a year ago on November 27, 2013. This law was intended to help GDOE save money on power by allowing them to purchase solar energy. However, procurement of these essential solar panels has not been completed, and the rate the process is going, we're losing money. We should have been saving had the panels already been procured and installed. Also, GDOE and GSA have been struggling to communicate and reach agreement on a contract to install security systems in all of our schools. In order to prevent this from happening again, this bill gives DOE the authority to handle the procurement process for purchasing solar energy. That was a statement that was provided by the speaker.
Do any of my colleagues have any questions?
Thank you, gentlemen. First of all, let me just lay the foundation that I am in full support of integrating renewable energy into our system. But quite frankly, I don't think that Bill 431 will do it, and here are the reasons why. I've been looking at the chronology of what has happened since Public Law 32-95 got enacted. And after that public law was enacted, within 49 days, GSA developed a draft request for information that it was going to send out to the market to see what prospective vendors, if they had any questions or comments. And GSA actually circulated this draft RFI to DOE, GEPA, Office of the Governor, and the BBMR, and did not receive any responses. So GSA went ahead and says, okay, then it's going to go out like they put it together. And they gave the vendors out in the market 14 days to respond. And so in the 14 days, 13 vendors actually responded. And GSA then began its evaluations of the responses. 49 days later, GSA compiled all these questions and comments and sent it out to DOE for response. And I imagine the questions are, what is it that you want, DOE? And so here we are today, and between GSA, DOE, the governor's office, DPW, GCC, UOG, everybody's chasing their tails. And to introducing a bill that simply takes GSA out of the picture, I don't believe does anything. So I think the problem is over there, but we're shooting over there. And so I really don't think 431 would do it. So, Mr. Boakola, you indicated, you know, to this date, GSA has not issued an RFP. And maybe part of that is because DOE hasn't defined what it wants. And so, again, taking GSA out of the picture and thinking that this is going to fix it, I don't think it's going to hit the mark. In addition to that, the existing public law 3295 says that a PPA provider will be selected using a multi-step bid. You kept mentioning an RFP. So I agree that this really should go out as whether it's multi-step or a one-shot IFB, it should be a bid, not an RFP. The third thing is that in the law right now, it says that whoever the PPA is that wins this contract to provide to DOE, that it shall only cover no more than 80% of the school's power needs. I'm trying to figure out where that 80% come from, because in the testimony during the public hearing for this public law 3295, which was, I think, Bill 74 or something.
32, correct.
30, yeah. Yep. I know that one of the GREA members was emphasizing the fact that one of the things that's holding back the penetration of renewables into the system is because the law right now puts a limit as to how large a system can be put in. For residential, it's 25 kW. For non-residential, commercial, it's 100 kW. And so if that is not desirable, then why are we putting in the law a limit of 80%? Personally, I feel that if you can fit on the rooftops of DOE three times what the school needs, then have at it. But it's something that the provider and GPA are going to need to work out. So somehow we're going to need to remove this 80% cap. I mean, I think that's almost as bad as 100 kW limit threshold. Now, we've seen that here we are today, 377 days, and we're still chasing our tails. And so I'm gonna, you know, I would like to present a model and get your reaction to it. But I really think that DOE should be looking at putting out a bid to rent its rooftop space. I have 10,000 square feet of rooftop that can be made available for the installation of renewable energy devices. And whoever gives me the highest rent plus a percentage of whatever excess production, then he gets to use all of my rooftop. In the meantime, I think it should be the GREA members that should be coordinating with GPA, who ultimately is going to receive this power. And so you guys work out an arrangement with GPA as to how much they will buy your power for. And in the case of DOE, if we need legislation that will remove the 100 kW limit, then we'll introduce legislation. In fact, I'm reporting out the bill that would increase the limit to 250 kW. But I think that discussion should be between, as Mr. Hagen here said, all the experts about renewable energy is in this room. And so I think these experts should be talking with GPA as to how can we make this a win-win situation for you as a producer and for GPA as a basically taking that power. And as far as DOE is concerned, they're just a landlord for rooftop space who wants a minimum rent. Plus, if you guys produce excess, then maybe they should get a percentage plus of that excess. And for me, that seems to be so much simpler in my layman's mind than to expect that DOE is going to actually sit down. Now, there's a problem in that I know that GREA has stepped forward and said, we've got experts and we can advise you on, you know, how to develop those specs. Well, that's great. But the procurement law also says that if you do that, whichever vendor does that conflicts himself out of a bid. So I think we can avoid that if GREA just sits down with GPA, you guys work it out in the same way that GPA did with that energy facility in Dundon, okay? And so it's a matter that when it comes to power production, the purchase and the sale of power should be between GPA and the power producer. DOE, I got rooftop space, you want to rent it? Go for the highest bidder. And so that's my thought on it as to how I think we're going to be able to move this thing. But to simply introduce legislation that takes out GSA out of the picture, 377 days later, I guarantee you, we'll be back here again. So I want to see this thing move forward just as much as you guys do. But we need to come up with the right solution to do it. I don't think 431 does it.
Thank you very much, Senator. If I may respond to that. Okay. thank you, Vice Speaker. You just started out with saying that GSA did go to the private sector, and there was 13 vendors that did respond. So I guarantee you that those 13 member companies who responded were at a degree association. In my first paragraph of my testimony, what I actually said here was that GREA supports the fact that GSA should not have this procurement. And we support an agency that can move this procurement forward. So if that's not GDOE, then we need to pick the right agency, because I can't agree with you more. We have no time to chase our tail. And 377 days from now, I do not want to be sitting here, because then it's too late. You know, it's a daunting task to get 36 schools done. And believe me, by the time that ITC credit expires at the end of 2016, institutional or private money is going to back away from power purchase agreements for a while until solar can come down again low enough where it supports doing it without that ITC credit. So we are running out of time. That is definitely a fact. My fear with GPA is, and this is my fear, to build a 26-megawatt plant down in Dandan at LEAC rate, that's possible. It could even be possible now at 14 and a half cents. That's what the LEAC rate is today. Possible. To do a 500-kilowatt system or 800-kilowatt system on a school at LEAC rate, it's impossible. So if there's some way that we could work out a reasonable price, and not just what the GREA members want, but what the market bears to build those systems, then that would definitely be a strong possibility. But that's my fear with GPA coming back and saying, well, you know, we can only purchase power at LEAC rate, and now, you know, in my testimony it says we not only need an entity that can move the structure or procurement process forward, but at the end of the day we need something that's bankable or financeable.
But aren't they doing it already with GCC? They actually have gotten together with GCC, and actually they've gotten it to the point where PUC is now looking at the rate structure that's being proposed. So they've moved it along, actually.
Was there any rate given at this time or not?
No, I think it's the LEAC rate plus something. I think, if I recall,
6, 14 and a half cents. That's what the LIAC rate is today.
Is it? Well,
yeah, it came way down.
Well, there was a spread there.
Yeah.
Enough of a spread that an investor, you know, can recover his cost and make a profit at it. And there's nothing at all wrong with making a profit.
Exactly.
That's right. So I think we have a model up at GCC that has moved along a lot further than we are here with the DOE issue. The model there is similar to what I was describing. There's just some difference nuances, but in general, it's pretty much, you know, where DOE would just become basically a landlord of rooftop space.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much. The senators have no further questions. Bill 431 is considered heard.
Thank you.
Speaker Wompat also introduced Bill 430. In Public Law 32-65, I identified $400,000 for GPD to purchase new police vehicles. They were able to procure 7 vehicles. 2 were received in October 14, and 5 more expected to be received this month. Chief of Police Fred Bradley reported in the letter to me that the police department was not able to procure mobile radios for these vehicles. There are copies of his letter available at the sign-in table. He requested the use of the remaining funds appropriated in Public Law 32-65 for an amount of $53,006 for mobile radios. This bill 430-32 redirects this money towards the purchase of these much needed radios. I don't see anybody here. No one has signed up. I received testimony from the Chief of Police, and that'll be included in the committee report. Bill 430 is deemed heard by this committee. The next bill to be heard will be Bill 427, which I introduce. It's a simple bill, just removing the last sentence in the composition of the board to remove the prohibition against a board member serving more than one term. I believe, Mr. President, you're here to testify.
Thank you, Mr. Vice Speaker, Oversight Chair for Cultural Affairs and Government Operations, and all the great stuff that you do. The Department of Chamorro Affairs and its Council on the Arts and Humanities fully support Bill Number 427-32, Committee and Rules, an act to amend subsection 85103B of Title V of Guam Code Annotated relative to the composition of the Council on the Arts and Humanities. The Council acknowledges the need for its members' appointments to serve more than 4-year appointments without interruption. Over the years, the Council has had many notable appointees who would have continued their service to CAHA, but were limited in that appointees are only allowed no more than 4 years of service. The Department of Chamorro Affairs and CAHA are both grateful for your continued advocacy for the Arts and Humanities programs in Guam. Joseph Artero Cameron, President.
Thank you very much. I understand, Mayor Gorby, you're here on behalf of the Mayor's Council.
Afternoon, Vice Speaker and Senators. My name is Mayor Gogui, Mayor of Board of Chilampago, and I actually am here on behalf of the Mayor's Council of Guam. I've submitted written testimony, which I will read. It's short, it's I think to the point, and it was actually authorized by the Mayor's Council at a regular board meeting that we held last week, and it goes as such. As the current legislative liaison for the Mayor's Council of Guam, I've been authorized by majority of vote of the mayors and vice mayors at our regular monthly meeting held on Wednesday, December 3rd, 2014, to submit testimony in support of Bill 427-32 on behalf of the Mayor's Council. Additionally, during our discussions on this bill, the Mayor's Council is requesting an amendment to Bill 427-32 that will add a voting member to the governing board of the Council of on the Arts and Humanities, CAHA, to be appointed by the Mayor's Council of Guam. First, it is a position of the Mayor's Council that the basic intent of this bill to eliminate board appointments for more than 4 years without interruption is reasonable and appropriate, that the passage of this bill acknowledges the importance of continuity within CAHA's governing board in their efforts to maintain a strong sense of leadership and experience among these volunteers. And should our request for an amendment to this bill be supported by the legislature, we believe that this will further add to the continuity of leadership within CAHA's governing board. It has always been evident throughout our island's history that most of the arts and humanities programs for all ages rest on the support of the community and oftentimes the advocacy of the mayors and vice mayors of our island. With our requested amendment to this bill to add a voting member appointment from the Mayor's Council of Guam, we believe that this will further foster an even stronger relationship between CAHA, their governing board, and all of the villages of our island. However, it will be up to the legislature to determine if the board composition remains at 11 appointments by the governor or is reduced to 10 with the 11th appointment coming from the Mayor's Council of Guam. And since this appointment from the Mayor's Council does not involve any stipends or any financial requirements, there should be no budget concerns linked to this requested amendment. The Mayor's Council of Guam submits this letter of support and request for an amendment in hope that it receives favorable support from our senators, and if adopted and passed, the support of the governor. That oftentimes our island leaders seek out the support and assistance of our mayors and vice mayors of Guam, but in this case, we publicly offer up our assistance to the Council of the Arts and the Humanities and its governing board, and it's signed by me. Copies been sent to the Mayor's Council of Guam and Vice Mayor's of Guam.
I appreciate the letter, Mayor. We would have always wanted to have had a mayor. We have it on the fest pack, but I know that sometimes they you keep adding to our responsibility. As you put it, you guys have come forward and asked me to assume this responsibility, and we wholeheartedly support the idea of doing it. So thank you very much for getting the mayors on board to say that they want to come on to the CAHA board, and I'll make sure that that amendment is included in the bill.
Thank you. It just goes in line with what has been oftentimes perceived as a needed advocacy on the part of the mayors and the vice mayors, and that's our cultural and the humanities, and getting it out into the communities and finding those skill sets that maybe need a little extra funding to boost their skills and to promote our culture and our humanities. And by establishing this relationship, which just seemed to be appropriate, there was no reason for the mayors not to want to be on board with this this proposal.
And you're much too modest. I know there's many of you that have talents in all kinds of musical instruments and supported all the Pa'atatatana dancers in all of the villages. And so I want to thank the mayors for their support that they've been giving the culture preservation over the last decade. And we welcome your willingness to come on to this board and bless.
Thank you.
Members have any? No? Okay.
That's all I have.
Thank you. Thank you, and this committee is, Bill 427 is deemed.